Hello and welcome to S3 Recipes. My name is Aishwarya and today I'm going to show you how to make apple fritters. Apple fritters is a very easy recipe to make, and because there are so many apples in the market nowadays, green apples and the normal red ones, this is very easy and yummy. Let's look at the ingredients. We'll be needing some cut up apples, some milk, some vanilla essence, some eggs, some flour, sugar, and hot oil. Let's start by making the batter. First, we'll take in our flour. Ideally, you can use, the cake flour, the self-rising one, but I'm just using the normal one. Some sugar. Mix that well. Just add in the milk. And the eggs. Mix it well so that there are no lumps in it. Once that's done, add in your vanilla essence, just 2-3 drops would do, just to give it a nice flavor. If you want this to be really nice and fluffy, just add in some baking soda or baking powder. Now we add in our apples. Not much, just a little bit. Now that my oil is nice and hot, we are going to directly plunge the batter into the hot oil. Be careful when you do this. Keep some gap between the fritters, always stick. And keep in mind that the pan should be really hot so they don't stick. Now that our fritters are nice and golden, I'm going to take them all out, strain the oil. Don't want any excess oil in there. And just in case, I've kept some tissues on the plate. Soak all the oil in. Okay, so now that our apple fritters are all done, I'm going to garnish it with some cut up apples. These fritters really taste like cake. Their base and their batter is very cake-like, vanilla cake-like. And I'm going to garnish it with some honey. Just drizzle it around. Like so. So here we have it. Our apple fritters are all ready. Today we are going to make lemon apple juice. This juice is very yummy and very healthy. So let's look at the ingredients. We'll need some honey, sugar, lemon, cut up apples, salt and water. Let's start by heating our pan. Now we're going to add in our apples. We're going to let it cook for some time. Once it starts sizzling, we're going to add in our honey. Once the apples are nicely glazed with the honey, we're going to reduce the flame. And add in sugar if needed. Not much, just a little bit. So with this, what happens is that our apples get caramelized with the sugar and the honey, and it gives a nice roasted apple flavor. Let that caramelize around 2 minutes or so. Now that our apples are all caramelized, we're going to add in some salt just to balance in the flavor. And after the salt is added, I'm going to squeeze the juice of half a lime. Once the lime is in, it gives a really nice aroma. And once that's done, we're going to add in our water. Let that cook for around 10 to 15 minutes so that the apples get soggy and start to break inside the juice. If it's not breaking down, you can just add some water to it and blend it in the mixer, or just mash it with some like a spatula or so. The whole idea is to just make it into a juice. Once that is done, we're going to let this cool, and once it cools, we're going to serve it. So I'm going to put off the flame. If you want to speed the procedure, just add in some ice cubes so that it comes really cold rather than having a hot juice. This juice is now ready, and it's okay if the ice cubes are more, because after all it's just a juice and you have to cool it down. It's more like a squash, so once the juice goes in, it's going to melt the ice. So here we have it, our lime apple juice is all ready. Today we are going to be making cheesy mushroom chicken. This recipe is very easy. Now let's look at the ingredients. We'll need some mushrooms, some baby corns, some grated cheese, chili flakes, pepper, salt, some seasoning, that's some garlic powder, some oil and chicken. We'll start by heating our pan and heating our oil. We're going to add in around 3 tablespoons of oil and let that heat till it's nice and hot. Now that our oil is hot, we're going to add in our mushroom, baby corns. I'm going to saute it for around 2 to 3 minutes. While the baby corns and the mushroom are getting cooked, we're going to lower the flame and we're going to marinate our chicken by adding in some garlic seasoning, some salt, pepper and chili flakes. Mix it so that the chicken is evenly covered. I'm going to add some more of garlic. So by now our baby corns and the mushrooms are done. Now just add one more spoon of oil to help the chicken cook. Slowly add in the chicken. Okay, now that the chicken is done, as you can see, it's become a bit brown and golden. And very gently going to add some cheese. Not much, as we don't want the pan to get burnt with it. This starts to melt. I'm going to put it into this bowl. We're going to garnish it with our cheese. Put a generous amount of cheese on top. Put some pepper on top, the cheese, to season the cheese as well. Some chili flakes. And a bit of the garlic seasoning which we use to marinate the chicken. So here we have it, our cheesy mushroom chicken is all ready. Do try this at home. Today we are going to make chicken mayo sandwiches. I'm Aishwarya and I'm going to show you this amazing recipe which is full of proteins and something which kids love. Let's look at the ingredients. We need some boneless chicken, garlic mayonnaise, butter, pepper, green chilies, finely chopped onions, cooking oil, coriander leaves, cheese slice and some bread. So now we're going to fry our chicken breast. I've kept the pan to get heated up now. As soon as it's hot, I'm going to add some cooking vegetable oil. Once that's nice and hot, we're going to add in our chicken breast and let that fry till the time it's really beautiful and golden brown. Fry the chicken on both sides till it's nice and golden brown. Now that we've fried this chicken for around 5 to 7 minutes, it's nice and golden brown. Let's take it into our cutting board. And carefully shred the chicken. It's either your choice to make them chunky or if you want them to be like really shredded pieces. So now we're going to make the mixture of this amazing chicken spread. Firstly, we'll take our chicken and we'll add it into a bowl. And then I'm going to take some garlic mayonnaise. Mix it together well so that all the chicken pieces are evenly covered. Now for some flavor, we're going to add some onions. Just some finely chopped onions. And if you want to take this to another level, you can add some green chilies. Just a bit. It's according to your taste. Now we're going to add our pepper. And if you want to give it a twist with some herbs, add some coriander. The spread is something that you can keep in the fridge for a very long time and you can use it for about a week or so. And it goes along with everything, if it's brisket or if it's just a sandwich or even, you know, something like a Subway, it just goes really well with everything. So now we'll assemble our sandwich. I'm taking a slice of bread and just giving it a generous amount of cheese on top. This is a very filling sandwich. It's something which you can have for breakfast and a good start for the day. It's healthy and full of protein and nutrition. Okay, so now we're going to add in our mixture. Place it on top of the cheese. If you want, you can put another layer of cheese on top just to make it a little more filling. Kids usually love cheese, so it's something that they'll really like, and because it has chicken, it's something that they will really love to eat. Once the slice is ready, I'm going to apply some butter because we're going to toast this. And if you don't have a toaster, you can either pan fry it or toast it on the pan. That'll do too. Just be careful of the filling inside. We are going to let that toast for some time. So let's check if our sandwiches are ready. Oh. Let's take them into a plate. So here you go, your chicken mayo sandwiches are ready. Do try it at home. Today I'm going to show you how to make chocolate fudge. This is an easy and yet very yummy chocolate dish, which is just, you know, has a very less amount of ingredients. So let's look at them. We need some condensed milk, some compound chocolate, and just some butter. We're going to start by keeping a pan on the stove, adding our condensed milk in. Keep stirring till the condensed milk becomes thinner. And now add equal parts of chocolate. Keep in mind that the heat should not be too much or it will burn the chocolate. Now we'll add in some dry fruits to make this fudge a little more rich. Once the mixture is nicely boiled and separating, pour it into a container lined with cling film. Be very careful as this mixture is really hot at this point. Keep this mixture outside for around 30 minutes at room temperature and let it cool down, and then keep it in the fridge for around an hour. Now that it's been an hour, we're going to take out our chocolate fudge. Now with the help of the cling film, we'll pull out our fudge. And cut them into pieces. Once we are done cutting them, now to garnish them, I'm going to roll them in some cocoa powder. So what this does is, all the extra sweetness goes into the bitter cocoa and it balances it well and also makes it look very yummy.
So here we have it, our chocolate fudge.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make coconut fritters. Many a times we have breadcrumbs or the sides of the breads left behind after, you know, kids have their sandwiches or something. They really don't like the sides of the bread. So today I'm going to teach you an easy way of utilizing this bread and making something very delicious. Let's look at the ingredients. So the ingredients needed are some milk, some flour, some ground sugar or even normal sugar will do, some breadcrumbs, coconut, and some oil for deep frying. So we're going to start making our batter, and side by side I've kept some oil to get heated. So while that happens, we're going to gently add in our coconut, which is freshly grated. Keep in mind that the coconut has to be freshly grated or this will not really bring out the taste. Mix it evenly, see to it that everything is mixed well. Now add in your sugar. Add in some milk. This is a quick and easy snack which goes really well with tea and looks really pretty once it's done. Mix it till the time the whole batter is nice and moist, not too watery. We don't want it to be watery. Now add some flour in to bind everything inside and mix it evenly so there are no lumps. You wouldn't want any lumps in your mouth when you're eating this because it's very unappetizing. Take care when you're making the batter. This might get a bit messy, but you'll have to use your hands to get this done properly. Once the batter is done, if you keep these two in the middle of your hand, it'll hold the shape that you give it. Our oil is getting nice and hot now. I'm going to make this into small little balls and fry them. See to it that the oil is really hot, otherwise our fritters will consume too much of oil and we don't want that. Once you add in your fritters, just lower the gas so that it doesn't burn and keep gaps between the fritters. I'm going to gently toss this. This doesn't take much time to get cooked. It's an easy procedure and it's quick and fast and fuss-free. Our first fritter is done really well, nice and golden brown. If you don't want it to be this brown, you could, you know, toss it before. This is the ideal color. I like really golden brown color, which looks really amazing. So our coconut fritters are all ready and we're going to start garnishing it. So I have some powdered sugar right here. Just going to drizzle this on top of it and that's it. And if you want to add it, make it a little more coconutty, add some leftover coconut on top. So here we have it, our coconut fritters are all ready.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make chocolate pancakes. It's quite easy and something which kids would love to have for breakfast. It's absolutely yummy. You can serve it with whipped cream, honey and even maple syrup. So what we need for this pancake is some maida, some whipped cream, some melted butter, sugar, cocoa, one egg and some milk. We are going to start combining all of the ingredients together and making a batter for it. First, I'm going to add all the dry ingredients together. Now I'll add some cocoa. Mix it well. Once that is done, we're going to add in some sugar. Our egg, and and gently pour in some milk. Add in some butter. See to it that there are no clumps in the batter. Now we're going to heat our pan and going to pour in the batter and make some lovely pancakes. Now we're going to add our butter to the pan. Once it's nice and hot, with the help of a ladle, I'm going to pour it in. And let it cook till you see small bubbles coming on top of it. And we're gently going to flip our pancake. I will transfer it into a plate. So here we have it, our pancakes are all ready. We're going to add some whipped cream and some chocolate sauce on top just to make it extra delicious. So here we have it, our pancakes are all ready.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make chocolate vanilla mousse. These are two mousses which we are going to combine together, and we are going to make this just with a very few amount of ingredients. Let's look at them. So here I have my vanilla whipped cream, which is just some whipped cream to which I've added a little bit of vanilla essence, some chocolate sauce or melted chocolate will do, and some whipped cream. Now what we're going to do is, we're going to add in our chocolate sauce into our whipped cream. And we're going to mix that. If you want some darker shade, you could opt for melted chocolate or add some more of the syrup in. I'd go with this nice brown cream color. So before we start to put this in, I'm going to take my glass and we're just going to run the chocolate sauce on the sides like so. And let that drip down. We're going to gently take our mousse into our piping bag. I have two piping bags today because we have two mousses, different kinds of vanilla whipped cream and chocolate mousse. So in one I'm going to mix my whipped cream and in one I'm going to add my chocolate mousse. I'm going to start from the bottom, and as you can see, the chocolate has now reached the bottom of the glass. If you want, you could add some more on the end so that it has a nice flavor at the end of the glass. Now I'm going to start plating this. After one layer is done, add the second layer of whipped cream on top, like so. and then a final layer of our whipped cream on top. With that, I'm going to garnish it with some chocolate sauce on the top just for a final finish. Just drizzle it on top of your chocolate mousse and the vanilla whipped cream. Just like so. Could add in some more if you like. So here we have it, our chocolate vanilla mousse is all ready. Today I'm going to show you how to make chocolate mousse. This is probably the easiest recipe you'll ever come across with the most minimal ingredients. Let's look at them. All we'll be needing is some chocolate, dark chocolate that is, which I will melt in the microwave, some whipped cream and just some chocolate shavings for garnishing. Now we're going to melt the chocolate in the microwave oven for around 1 minute. Let's wait till that's done. Now that our chocolate is all melted, I'm going to mix it so that the bits that have not melted melt in the heat of the chocolate. Now what we're going to do is, we'll take our whipped cream, which is nice and thick. We're going to add 1 spoon of our chocolate into it. As the chocolate is added into the whipped cream, you will notice that it starts to get a little thicker. This mousse can be used for frosting as well, which will make really amazing frosting for any cake. That's it, our mousse is all ready. Put it into a piping cone. Now we're going to pipe it into a glass, but before we do that, I'm going to add some chocolate shavings on the bottom. So, I'm going to pipe it. Put another layer of the chocolate. We'll add some more chocolate. This chocolate is completely optional, but it just makes the mousse much more richer. We're going to add a final touch of the chocolate on top. Now we're going to garnish it with some chocolate sauce. Here we have it, our chocolate mousse is all ready. Today we are going to be making honey lemon mousse. This mousse is extremely yummy and very simple to make, something appropriate for desserts. Your guests will love it, and so now let's look at the ingredients. We need some whipped cream powder. If you don't have any whipped cream powder, you could use some whipped cream cream which is available in the supermarkets. Some honey, some lemon, cold water and a bowl. We're going to start by making our whipped cream. For that, I'm going to take some powder in here, some whipped cream powder, just a little bit. And I'm going to add just little by little some water into this, help of a blender. Or if you don't have a blender, it's completely okay. You could use a fork or something. We're going to mix this. And to this we are going to add a spoon of water, and I'm going to blend it in with the use of a fork. Beat it like really fast so the air starts to work and the cream starts to whip up. This is a quick dessert which you can make really fast, you know, something which you can store in the fridge and even have later. Our whipped cream is now getting thicker. So now that our whipped cream is done, it starts to leave trails on the whipped cream itself. So we're going to know if it's done by tilting the bowl like so, and if the whipped cream doesn't fall, it's completely done well. Now, because my quantity is really less, I'm going to add like around half a spoon of honey lime. Just going to drizzle that on top. I'm going to mix it in. Once that is done, I'm going to take my lime. I'm going to cut that and squeeze lemon into it. Not a lot, we don't want this to be really sour. Whip the whipped cream really fast so that everything blends in. That's it, our whipped cream and our mousse is now done. I have a disposable icing bag here and I'm going to add in the mousse into it. So once our mousse is into the piping bag, we're going to take our shot glass and we're gently going to fill it. So now that we have made our mousse, I'm going to drizzle it with some honey for just some garnishing. Once that's done, we're going to garnish it with one lime. That's it. Our honey lemon mousse is all ready. Today I'm going to be teaching you how to make garlic bread. Garlic bread is something which everyone really loves and everyone enjoys it. Something that is very common in nowadays fast food, you know. It's a very easy recipe. Now let's look at the ingredients. We'll be needing some chili flakes, some minced garlic, butter, oregano and bread. First we'll take some soft butter, put it into a bowl, add some minced garlic into that and nicely mash this together. You could melt the butter, but I would recommend that you keep this soft butter. It's easier to apply on the bread. And the bread, I have cut it with a cookie cutter into shapes. If you want, you could keep the regular size. This is just if you want to make the presentation a little more better. Mix that well and see to it that all the butter is mixed well with the garlic. Once that is done, I'm going to start my stove and just going to add a little bit of butter, just grease it, not much, because our bread itself has a lot of butter on it. I'm going to apply the butter and the garlic mixture on top of the bread and we're going to place it like so. Add some oregano, some chili flakes, Now we'll turn our garlic bread once it's nice and hot. And if you want, you could add the butter's mixture on the sides of the pan so that it doesn't go waste. Now we'll take our garlic bread from the pan into our serving plate. Once it's nice and hot, we're going to add in some chili flakes just for flavor. You could skip this part if you want, but this is just for seasoning. And some oregano. See, here we have it. Our garlic bread is all ready.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make hot chocolate, something that kids absolutely love. And as December is close by, it's an appropriate dish. Let's look at the ingredients, shall we? So the ingredients for today's drink are cocoa powder, instant coffee powder, some chocolate, whipped cream, and some whole milk. The coffee powder is something which gives a great punch to the chocolate and makes it much more chocolatier. So I would opt for some coffee powder, or if you don't have any, it's completely okay because it's just optional. Now that the milk has come to a boil, we are gently going to pour it. Let's keep the milk still as it is for around 20 seconds or so that the heat of the milk may completely melt the chocolate and may infuse with the milk and make a great flavor. Now that it's been around 10 to 20 seconds, we're going to start stirring so that the chocolate gets mixed. So now we'll pour our hot chocolate into the glass. Now to make this even yummier, we're going to top it with some whipped cream. And sprinkle some cocoa. Over it. So here we have it, our hot chocolate is ready.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make fudgy chocolate brownies. These brownies are really appropriate for Christmas, and as they're coming near, you can make this for your friends and family. Let's look at the ingredients. For this recipe, we'll be needing some sugar, baking soda, baking powder, some cocoa powder, 1 tablespoon vanilla essence, 150 grams of butter, 250 grams of chocolate, 2 eggs, 1 cup of milk, and 180 grams of maida or all-purpose flour. We're first going to start by heating our water. I have a double boiler here. If you don't have one, just keep one utensil on top of the other. Just see to it that the water doesn't boil and come into the bowl, as it will completely mess up the chocolate. We're going to add in our chocolate now. 250 grams of chocolate goes in. Let the water heat up, and with the heat of the water, we're going to melt this chocolate. Okay, now that our chocolate has started to melt, we're going to stir it very slowly. And we're going to add in some soft butter. I have butter here, and I've kept it outside, so it's turned really soft. That's exactly what we want. When the water comes to a boil, just keep in mind that the water doesn't get into the chocolate, or it'll completely mess up the chocolate. Grease the butter on the tray like so. Evenly spread it, so you don't want a lot of butter on one side, or it's going to completely ruin the brownie, the outer layer. So I'm going to add in some all-purpose flour and just spread it like so. Once it starts to melt, we're going to add in the rest of our butter. and stir that. Have it, our butter and the chocolate is all melted. I'm going to take that off the pan. Now that the chocolate's melted, we are going to add in all the liquid ingredients. I'm going to add my tablespoon of vanilla essence in there. As that cools down, I'm going to add in the rest of my baking soda here. I'm just going to put a pinch of that, not a lot, as it gives a soapy taste if it's too much. Some baking powder and mix that well into the all-purpose flour. Now we're going to add our cocoa. You could add in some coffee powder to bring out a little more of flavor in this. Okay, so we're going to mix that well. Once that is mixed, either you could add in your sugar into the bowl, or I prefer adding it into the hot chocolate because as it's hot, it'll melt faster. So here we have it, our chocolate and our sugar, powdered sugar. You could use a regular one, but powdered gets melted faster. So just see to it that there are no lumps when you're mixing it. Once this is mixed, we're going to add in our milk. About 1 cup. I'm not going to put the whole thing, it's according to how thick the batter is at the moment. So now that our chocolate, sugar and everything is mixed in, I'm going to add my 2 eggs in. For this I'll be using a blender. Mixture is completely done, the wet ingredients are all done. I'm going to add in the dry ingredients very slowly, be careful, just a little. We're going to add in all the ingredients on the side as well, as we don't want that to go waste. Just going to add in my rest of the sugar. That's it, our batter is all ready now. Okay, I have lined my baking tray with some butter paper so that it doesn't stick, just in case. And now I'm going to pour in my batter. Just equally spread it, it'll go on its own. Just pour it in the middle, like so. Your batter should be as thick as this. It should leave trails on the batter, like so. Like you can see how it goes. That's how thick your batter should be. Now that my brownie's batter is all ready and in my baking tray, we are going to bake it for around 35 minutes on 180 degrees Celsius. Now let's wait for around 35 minutes. Now that our 35 minutes are done, we're going to check on the brownie. We're going to let that cool for around 30 minutes so that it's nice and warm when we remove it out of the baking tray. Now that our brownie is all done, spread it some chocolate all around. Now we'll grate some chocolate shavings on top of this. Spread it all around. And now pour some chocolate sauce on it. So here we have it. Our fudgy chocolate brownie is all done. Today we are going to be making fruit roll-ups. This fruit roll-up is very easy and simple to make, very yummy and something very appropriate for snacks or for breakfast. Children will love this. This is just a French toast but with a different twist. It has fruit in it and some yummy filling in it which makes it even yummier. Let's look at the ingredients.
The ingredients needed are some butter, which is really soft and not really hard, you know, in the fridge. Some powdered sugar, some chocolate spread, some chocolate sauce, some apples, one egg, milk, some cinnamon and ground sugar, and bread.
We're first going to start making our fruit roll-ups by preparing our bread. We're first going to cut off the edges. You can make something yummy with the breadcrumbs in the end. We're going to take our chocolate spread and apply it on one side of the bread, like so. Remember not to put too much, or while frying it might just come out. Now add in your apples. And gently roll them in, like so. Once this is done, I'm going to take a bowl. And I'm going to add one egg to it. And just some milk. You know the basic French toast mixture which you usually make at home for breakfast? It's exactly the same. Mix this well so that the milk and the eggs may become a good batter. Now gently add in some powdered sugar. It's not necessary to have powdered sugar, but it just makes the procedure much more faster and is less time consuming. And we're going to start heating our pan. When the pan gets hot, we're going to add in our butter. This can be made in oil, but with butter it has an extra richness to it, you know. Adds more flavor. And now what we're going to do is we're going to roll our mixture and we're going to seal the downward part so that, you know, it gets completely sealed and it doesn't open up later. Let that fry. Be very gentle when you're rolling the bread in it. See how nice and golden it's become? That's exactly the color we want. Be a little careful when you're rolling this. And fry it from all sides evenly. That's one fruit roll-up that's ready. Let it cool before you roll it in the cinnamon and sugar mixture. That's nice and brown. It's very important that the edges are well cooked or it's just going to come out. So my fruit roll-ups are all ready. We're going to take it and roll it in our cinnamon and sugar coating, just for, you know, little presentation. This is optional, completely optional. If you want, you can do this. If you don't want, it's completely okay. But the cinnamon gives it, you know, a spicy flavor. This can make a really yummy, you know, Christmas morning breakfast. And we're going to pour some chocolate sauce on the top. If you don't have chocolate sauce, it's completely okay. This is just for presentation. I'm going to pour in our chocolate sauce. So here we have it, our fruit roll-ups are all ready. Today I'm going to teach you how to make egg rolls. This is one of my favorite dishes, something that my close friend had once taught me. So let's start making this. We need some chili flakes, some mixed vegetables. I have some onion, capsicum, some carrots, some oregano, some oil, pepper, salt and two eggs. We'll start making the omelette by preparing the batter. I'm going to start by breaking two eggs in a bowl. And now we'll add some pepper, some salt, some chili flakes, and some oregano. Mix it. We'll start by heating our pan and heating our oil. And let that heat till it's nice and hot. And now we'll add batter. And now we'll add some vegetables. I have some onion, capsicum, some carrots.
Now we're going to add in some more vegetables. Instead of vegetables, you can add anything you want. Now that our egg roll is done, I'm going to plate it. Now we're going to cut the omelette. Now if you want, you could add some chili flakes on top just for some seasoning if you feel like it's necessary. And serve it with some tomato sauce and that's all.
So here we have it, our egg rolls are all ready. Today I'm going to teach you how to make corn sprout salad. The salad is completely filled with proteins and nutrients. Now let's look at the ingredients. For this recipe, we'll be needing some cooking oil, some mustard seeds, pepper, salt, sprout and some corn. We'll start by adding some oil into our pan and let that heat. Once the oil is hot, we're going to add in our mustard seeds and wait till the mustard starts to splutter. Once that starts happening, we're going to start adding in our sprouts. Around 1 cup of sprout goes in. And we're going to start stirring this and sautéing it so that all the oil is covered evenly. Add in the corn, around 1 cup of corn. Mix it well. At this point, you could add in chili flakes, parsley or something, anything you like. But I'm just going to add in some pepper as I want this a little plain. Keep sautéing it for around 10 minutes till the sprouts and the corn are well cooked. I'm going to add in my salt. I'm going to stir that for around 2 to 3 minutes more. And that's it. Our salad is all done. Now we're going to put our salad into the plate. I'm going to add some chili flakes on top of that, just for some extra seasoning. And here we have it. Our easy corn sprout salad is now ready. Today we are going to be making stir-fried chicken. The ingredients we'll be needing for this recipe are some julienne cut carrots, some capsicums, some onions, butter, coriander, salt, pepper, cabbage and chicken. We're going to start making the stir-fried chicken by first heating and melting our butter. On the side, I'm going to marinate our chicken in salt and pepper. We're going to add in our butter. And here we have our boneless chicken. Not going to add much salt because when we fry the vegetables, we'll be adding in salt. And we don't want it to get too salty because the butter as well has some salt in it. Some pepper. Now that our butter has melted, we're first going to add in our carrots. Then our capsicums. Onion, and we don't want this to cook completely, we want it to be a little crunchy, so don't let it get really cooked. Now we'll add in some salt, not much because the chicken itself has some salt in it, some pepper, Now we'll take our chicken and add it in slowly. Once we add the chicken and it gives out water, we're going to add in our cabbage for some extra crunch. Once the chicken is cooked through, we're just going to add in some garnishing. I let this chicken cook for around 5 to 6 minutes or so. Don't add your whole coriander, as we'll be needing to garnish it when we are plating this dish. Instead of the whole coriander, you could actually put some parsley in. And some, you know, chili flakes, as I told you earlier, thyme or rosemary. It'll just enhance the flavor of the dish. And now we're going to plate it. Coriander. I want to keep it really plain, but this is a very good side dish for any dinner or lunch. And it's also, you know, kind of like a salad. So here we have it, our stir-fried chicken is all ready. Today we are going to be making spicy chicken pizza. This pizza is very appropriate for lunch and dinner. Let's look at the ingredients. We'll be needing some grated cheese, some baby corn, some tomatoes, oil, salt, pizza sauce, pepper, some seasoning, chicken, chili flakes. I have some vegetable here that was sauteed in oil, pepper and salt and a pizza base. We are going to start by sauteing our chicken in the pan. So let's heat our oil. I'm going to start by putting 2 spoons of oil, not much. We just want the chicken to be coated with oil, not fried in it. Now we're going to add in our chicken. I've cut these into thin pieces so that we can spread them evenly. and that the whole pizza is not covered with the whole chicken. Now I'm going to add in some pepper, some salt, some chili flakes, and 1 spoon of the pizza sauce. I'm going to fry this. If you want, you could add some more. Let that fry for around 30 seconds and then we'll take them off the pan. Now that our chicken is done, I'm going to put it into this bowl. Okay, now we're going to assemble our pizza. I'm going to take this grill and place my base on it. Apply a generous amount of sauce on top. See that it's equally spread on every side. We don't want too much on one side and less on the other. Okay, now we're going to add in our cheese. I'm putting a lot of cheese in this so that becomes really gooey, but keep some aside as we'll drizzle some cheese on top of the chicken as well. Now I'm going to take my vegetables and I'm going to put it on top of this, not too much, just a little. I have some baby corn right here. I'm going to put that as well. Some tomatoes. This is going to be a very filling pizza as it is having a lot of toppings on it. Now our chicken on the top. We've not let it cook completely because it's going to go back in the oven, so it'll cook there as well. Now, as I said earlier, drizzle some more cheese on top of all this so it's a little more yummy. And if you feel that the spiciness is too much, this will decrease it. And that's all. Our pizza is now ready to go into the oven for about 7 minutes. Let that cook for around 7 minutes. Now that 7 minutes are done, let's check our pizza. Our pizza is done. The cheese has melted. I'm just going to transfer this into our cutting board. So now to season this, we're going to take some chili flakes. As the name says it all, we're going to make it spicy. Some pizza seasoning, regular oregano, chili flakes and parsley would also do. So here we have it, a spicy chicken pizza is all ready.
Today I'm going to show you how to make pepper mushroom. This is a very spicy and yummy dish, something which goes well for a side dish as well. Let's look at the ingredients.
We'll be needing some mushrooms, some chili flakes, salt, oil and some pepper. We're going to start by heating our pan. For this recipe, we have to make sure that the pan is really hot so that we can cook our mushrooms faster. Once this is hot, we're going to add in our mushrooms. And we're going to saute it. Once the mushrooms start cooking, we're going to add in our salt. Chili flakes. and some pepper. And that is exactly what we want. We want the water to evaporate. Saute the mushrooms so that the water is completely taken in by the mushrooms. And the water is what has the flavor of the mushrooms. So that's it. Our mushrooms are all done. Now that our mushrooms are ready, we are going to start plating it. We're going to garnish our pepper mushrooms now. So here we are. Our pepper mushrooms are all done. Today I'm going to teach you how to make mushroom scrambled eggs. These are really yummy scrambled eggs which are very simple to make. Let's look at the ingredients. For this recipe, we'll be needing some mushrooms, cut up onions, 2 eggs, pepper, butter, chili flakes and salt. So we'll start by heating up our pan and adding in some butter. Let that heat up and melt the butter. Once the butter is nicely melted, we're going to add in the onions, not too much, just a little bit, as we want the flavor of the mushrooms to be more in this. We're going to add in our mushrooms now. Stir that well. Once the mushrooms start to cook, it starts to leave its water and it shrinks in size. So even if you add too much of mushrooms, it's completely okay. It's going to anyway shrink and make a nice sauce. I'm going to put in some chili flakes, some salt and some pepper. Not too much pepper, as we have chili flakes right there. Now that the water started to escape, we are going to quickly put in our eggs. But before we put in the eggs, I'm going to beat it nicely. Keep mixing this nicely so that all the juice and the mushroom get sauteed well with the eggs and make a nice scrambled egg. Keep mixing this. And if you feel like, you could add some more pepper in the end. Not too much, just a bit. Give it a final saute. Now plate our scrambled eggs. Now you could top it off with some cheese, grated cheese on the top. Just put it in the microwave for some time so that the cheese melts. And after we plate this, we're going to garnish it with some chili flakes. So here we have it, our mushroom scrambled eggs are all done.
Today I'm going to show you how to make mint mushroom rice. This fried rice is filled with flavor and is easy and simple to make. So let's look at the ingredients. So for this fried rice, we'll be needing some cooked rice, butter, black pepper powder, salt, a mixture of garlic, butter and mint, and some mushrooms. We're going to start making this fried rice by adding our mixture into a hot pan, like so. And fry it for around 30 seconds. Now we're going to add in our mushrooms. And saute it so that the mushrooms are evenly covered with the mixture. Leave the mushrooms as they are for about 2 minutes until the water from the mushroom evaporates. We don't want all the water to evaporate as it contains a lot of flavor in it. So we'll quickly add in our salt and a hint of black pepper. Now I'm going to add in my boiled rice. Saute this till the rice is completely and evenly covered in the gravy. Now that our fried rice is ready, see, here we have it, our mint mushroom fried rice.
Today I'll be showing you how to make kiwi mousse. This is a very simple dessert and we're going to start making it. Let's look at the ingredients. All we'll be needing for this is some kiwi crush and some whipped cream. We're going to start by adding our crush into the whipped cream. Now, if suppose your crush is too sweet, you could add some lime just to balance it out, because the whipped cream already has a lot of sweetness in it. I'll get too much of sweetness if you add something very sweet to it. So keep mixing it. Just add some more of the crush in. It's okay if you can't see any color, because the crush will give it a lot of flavor within. If you would like to enhance the color, you could add some of the food colorings which you get in the market nowadays. But we're just going to keep it this way. And now we're going to pipe it into our glass. So first, before I pipe it, I want some of the crush on the bottom. We're going to gently take our mousse into our piping bag. Push it down gently. And we're going to start piping it in. I'm going to put in my kiwi now. And then again our mousse goes in. That we're just going to garnish it with some of the kiwi pieces. You could cut up some fresh kiwi if you want to. So here we have it, our kiwi mousse is all ready. Today I'm going to show you how to make strawberry mousse. Let's look at the ingredients. For this recipe, we'll be needing some strawberry crush and some whipped cream. First, we're going to take our strawberry crush and add it to our whipped cream here and mix that well. After that, we're going to put it into our piping cone. So before we start plating, I'm going to take some syrup and we're just going to gently let that drizzle on the sides of the shot glass. And as it goes down, it'll settle on the base. Now we're going to pipe our mousse into this. If you want, you could drizzle some of the strawberry on the side or on the top, like so. So here we have it, our strawberry mousse is all ready. Today I'm going to teach you how to make vegetarian delight pizza. So we're going to need to look at the ingredients. They're quite simple, you'll get it everywhere in the market nowadays. Let's look at them. We'll need some capsicum, some cut up baby corns, some tomatoes, seedless. I've removed all the seeds so that they don't wet the base. Some onions, some carrot, salt, mushrooms, some pizza mix, pepper, cheese, some pizza sauce for the base, oil, and a pizza base. We'll start by sauteing our vegetables first in some hot oil so that they are not raw. I'm going to start by putting oil, onions, capsicums, some carrots, pepper, salt. Not too much salt, as the pizza base itself will have some salt in it, and the cheese as well. I'm going to put it into this bowl. Two spoons of oil, not much. Mushrooms, some pepper, some salt, I'm going to put it into this bowl. Okay, now we're going to assemble our pizza. I'm going to take this grill and place my base on it. Apply a generous amount of sauce on top. Now we're going to add in our cheese. I'm putting a lot of cheese in this. That becomes really gooey. Our pizza is now ready to go into the oven. So now that our 5 minutes are done, we're going to check on the pizza and see if it's all ready. Our pizza is done. The cheese has melted. Some pizza seasoning, regular oregano, chili flakes and parsley would also do. So here we have it, our vegetarian delight pizza is all ready.
Today I'm going to show you how to make tomato spinach soup. This soup is full of nutrients and it's really yummy and something which is more like a comfort food than the normal soup. So let's look at the ingredients. We'll be needing some finely chopped onions, some salt, some Maggi cubes, red chili powder, black pepper, green chilies, ginger and garlic, tomatoes chopped finely, some spinach, butter, and vegetable oil if needed. First, we'll start by heating our pan. And we'll add in our butter. So in case you do not want to use butter, you can use vegetable cooking oil. The butter just gives it a little much more better flavor. Once the butter is melted, I'm going to add in my ginger garlic. Then we'll add in our finely chopped onions. Once the onion become light brown and translucent, add in your chopped tomatoes. And a few green chilies. Once the tomatoes are soft, add in your black pepper. Some red chili powder. And salt. Now gently add in some Maggi cubes. Now break the Maggi cube into powder and add it evenly into the mixture. If you do not have Maggi cube, you can either use vegetable stock, which does the same. After the tomatoes are soft, let them cook for another minute. After a minute, add in some water. Once the soup comes to a boil, we're going to add in our roughly chopped spinach. Now if you want, you could grind this soup so that it's a little more coarse, but I like it with the pieces in it. Boil it for half a minute and then serve it in a bowl. Now that our soup has come to a boil, we're going to pour it into our bowl. Here we have it, our tomato spinach soup, quick and easy.
Today I'm going to teach you how to make stuffed mushrooms. Stuffed mushrooms are something very yummy, and let's look at the ingredients now. For this recipe, we'll be needing some spinach, some mushroom stems which I've chopped finely, butter, oil, the tops of mushroom which we are going to stuff, the salt, some sesame seeds, tomato, corn, pepper, and some onions and garlic chopped finely. Now we're going to start by heating our pan and adding in some butter and just one small tablespoon of oil so that the butter doesn't burn. Once it's nicely melted, we're going to add in our onions and our garlic and saute it till it's nice and translucent. Once the onions start to get a little softer, we're going to add in our salt. Now when we add in the salt, what the onion does is it gives out its flavors and makes the gravy much more yummier. This gravy that we are making is what we're going to stuff into the mushroom. Now that my onions are nice and translucent, I'm going to add in some pepper. Give that a good stir. Once that is done, we are going to add in our mushroom stems and our sweet corn. Around 1 cup of sweet corn. Give that a good stir. And if you feel that the oil is a little bit less, you can add in some oil or some butter. I'm just going to add in a little bit of oil. Once the mushroom starts giving out its water, we're going to add in the tomatoes. 1 cup of chopped tomatoes. Let that sit for around 5 minutes till the tomatoes get nice and soft and saucy, because that's what's going to be the filling. Once the tomatoes are cooked, I'm just going to season it with a little bit of chili flakes. Now the chili flakes are completely optional. This is just to add a little bit more of seasoning into this base. We are gently going to add in our spinach. Stir that softly and take care that it doesn't fall off. The spinach completely changes the flavor of the base and gives it another taste and a look. It makes it prettier. Keep mixing them properly so that the flavors are well mixed together and it has a great taste. So we're just going to heat this on the in the warmth of the pan. Once it's nicely sorted, now I'm going to transfer it into a bowl. Now we're going to take the same pan which we used for the sauce, and we're going to fry the tops of the mushroom in that so that the flavor is not lost. So we'll start doing that. Add in your butter. Not too much, just a little bit so that you know you can fry your mushrooms well. Once that is done, I'm gently going to place the mushrooms on the pan like so. Do this at a very low flame because you don't want the top of the mushroom to get burnt. Let it get toasted for around 2 minutes. Now that our mushrooms have been sitting for around 5 minutes, I'm going to turn these. It's supposed to be brown on the top. Not too brown, just some a little golden brown. The mushrooms will start giving out their water. Turn them gently. Be careful when you do this. You want the mushrooms to get cooked in their own water so it doesn't leave the flavor. And once the water is all evaporated from the bottom, we'll turn it, and on a low flame we're going to do this. Don't want the mushroom to burn. On a very low flame, I'm going to start adding my filling in like so. Now if you want, you could add in some grated cheese on the top with some seasoning, which should make this even more yummier. Now we're going to add in the filling for the rest of the mushroom. Slowly and gently, you don't want it to fall on the pan. It's okay if it does, but don't want any of it to go waste. See to it that there are no vegetables that fall out of the pan. You want it all to be there. And as you can see, the mushrooms have their water in it now. So the water from the mushrooms will also help the vegetables get some more flavor. Now I'm going to let this fry and let the mushrooms absorb all the water and cook in that for some time. Now I'm going to take my mushrooms into my plate. Be very careful when you do this, as you don't want the stuffing to fall out or it's just too much work. You could garnish this with some cheese if you like. Now we're going to garnish it with some chili flakes, just to add a little more spice to this. They look like small pots filled with vegetables. And now we're going to add our sesame on top. It gives a nice mild flavor. And that's all. Our stuffed mushrooms are all ready. Do try this at home. It'll make a great starters and your guests will love it. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, like, comment and share this video. Thank you.